couple of months ago, I talked to Bill Blythe about how science led him to be an organic gardener. Now I've come back to talk to Bill about his new book.
Bill, you've written a book.
Well, the book has come out. How about that? It's called Kitchen Garden Notes, a compilation of 24 of the Kitchen Garden Notes that I've been publishing in the Chew Valley Gazette for the last 30 years. And we hope that people will like it. It will also be useful because we're getting money for the church bells, for Chew Wagner Church.
So you're raising money for the restoration of the Chew Wagner bells?
Indeed we are, yes.
And
yes.
Was that the idea for the book as a fundraiser?
Yes, that is the idea, because I think there's an awful lot of things going on in the garden that we don't know anything about. And if we can bring that out, the importance of fungi, the importance of insects, the importance of birds, they're not things to be killed in the garden. You know, I've been an organic gardener for a very long time. And this is a culmination of this kind of thing. So if people are interested, I'm delighted.
And so let's assume someone's going to buy it as a present, or maybe for themselves. Does this take them through a year? What is the idea about the book?
It's the background to the gardening, the reasons that we are doing things that we are doing, and so much so that we must garden naturally. Gardening is about growing things, not killing things. So we don't need any pesticides, we don't need any herbicides, we don't need any artificial fertilizers. But that wasn't always the case. Organic was derided. If it was mentioned, it was ridiculed. And it's very difficult to say that now, but it's become routine. But I, as a working scientist, I wouldn't mention then to my colleagues that I was an organic gardener, because organic was mad. And it has been a sea change of attitudes, which of course is to the great value of the whole natural world.
The Soil Association, which already existed in the 1960s, they were just looking at farming.
Indeed.
And you wanted them to think about, or you wanted somebody to think about, how you could grow things organically in gardens.
Yes, indeed. But I wrote to the Soil Association. They were heavily into farming, and I never got a reply. And that was 60 years ago. I mean, this was before the time. Nobody considered organic as anything sensible. They were cranks. They were fringe. But shortly after, I saw a letter in the paper from a man called Lawrence Hills. Now, he has started a charity specifically for organic gardening. He was a man before his time. He was a man of ideas. Ideas used to fling off him like a Catherine Wheel sparks. And I wrote to him. He wrote back. He said, immediately, come and join us. So I became a member of an organisation that he had set up, which has a ridiculous name, which is still its official name. It was called the Henry Doubleday Research Association. But it now goes under the much better title, Garden Organic. So Lawrence got these people together. I was membership number 1,648. And Lawrence eventually realised that while he was a wonderful man of ideas in horticulture, he couldn't run an organisation. And he recruited two more people in order to help to run the whole thing. And eventually they ran the organisation for Lawrence. Now, I was involved in the council. All charities have to be run by a council, of course. And it blossomed. I mean, from being a couple of thousand members, we got up to 20 or 30,000 members. We had to reorganise the council, and by one means or another, completely undemocratically, I became chairman by the early 1990s. And we stayed that way for the next 12 years. And I think we were very useful in that by then the world had moved on. Organics had become sensible, had become part of orthodoxy. And really, to put it bluntly, I think we'd won the argument.
Tell me how you got involved with Prince Charles.
People don't realise just how hard-working the senior members of the royal family are. They are patrons of dozens and dozens of charities. Now, Prince Charles, again, another man before his time, has always been aware of the importance of the natural environment. And he has been the patron of Garden Organic, or Henry Doubleday, for all its time. And he has been a very valuable patron indeed. He visits the organisation regularly, he supports it, but behind the scenes, patrons do a wonderful amount of work. I mean, Prince Charles entertains various important and influential people in Highgrove. Members of the Council of HDRA are there as hosts occasionally, and we, I hope, have a small amount to play, but it's Prince Charles's power and attitude and presence that make the difference. You have an hour's conversation with a man who is going to be the King of England, for God's sake, who is interested in what you're in. This is wonderful.
Did you feel you got to know Prince Charles well?
Prince Charles is a very interested and interesting man. One can't say that one knows Prince Charles well, because he has his private life, but professionally, I think he was doing an extremely good job, not only for organics, but for the whole natural world. It's part of his own interest. Yes, I feel he was working wonderfully for that reason.
I'm just thinking now, just as a gardener at this point, what are the jobs you feel you should be doing in the garden at the minute? Or is winter time a time just to wait for nature?
It's now early December. Have you ordered next year's seeds? In the Gazette this month, you should have read it. It's already. That's the first job. Don't waste time reading this article. Go and order your seeds. So that is one thing. But then you have to start thinking January is seed sowing time, not April. January, February, March is the time that you're developing. Otherwise, you don't have any crops in June. So do things now. And the other thing, perhaps, is build a cold frame. If you haven't got a greenhouse, don't worry, but build a cold frame. I mean, and, well, the very least, you can put some daffodils in and keep them in the cold frame, and you'll have them in March. Life goes on. Gardening doesn't stop for winter. Good Lord, no. You get out there and do something.
And if you need any more inspiration throughout the year, you can always look at Bill's book.
Well, now, we and even the world need unseen friends. Now, that's it all to do about the importance of fungi, the importance of beetles, the importance of insects. So if people now are willing to support the Bells of Hugh Magna Church and buy the book, I'd be delighted.
And where can they get the book, Bill?
You can get the book at any of the villages in the valley, in the post offices. They all have them. They've all been very kind and said, yes, we'll keep the books. What should they be doing in February? Sow some peas in some...
And guttering.
Guttering, yes, yes. It's all in the book. Read about it. It's really... I can get excited about this. And Comfrey, yes. Well, there's Comfrey.
I'm just interested. Have you written anything about your own life? Because that would make an interesting story.
No. Nobody's interested in that.
Kitchen Garden Notes costs £10. All the money goes to the Chew Magna Bell Restoration Fund. And as well as getting it at local shops, you can order a copy at this email address.